Allow me, first of all, to express my appreciation of this ambitious initiative shown by the University of Aalborg to incorporate the martyrdom of Kaj Munk in a wider context, a specific context dealing with Christian opposition and resistance as distinct from other forms of opposition and resistance. Christian opposition and resistance do not, by itself, imply martyrdom. But martyrdom conveys a particular dimension and note to such an opposition and resistance. And it radicalizes the matter in question considerably. In the martyr's mind and perception, the intolerable situation that he experiences ultimately is a violation of the world order of God. By nature, martyrdom is a testimony, and the intention and purpose of a testimony is that it is received, that it creates an audience and a companionship. That indicates that the acknowledgement of martyrdom is a process, perhaps a very long and toilsome and ungrateful process, at worst an endless combat. There are innumerable examples of how difficult it is for the martyr and his adherents to assert his position. In Denmark, we have a saying, "Stjæleren er ikke værre end hæleren." The man who steals is no worse than the man who receives stolen goods. In Kaj Munk's opinion, that was exactly the case in Denmark's relationship to Germany before and during the war. And as a consequence of this matter of fact, Denmark had an account to settle with God and his divine world order. A bill had to be paid. For the sake of Christ and his demands, Kaj Munk clashed with the overriding attitude and politics of his own country. It is important to stress that Kaj Munk's agenda was ethical, religious, and that the antagonism to him is preponderantly ideological, political, and secular. That creates an atmosphere of a talk across the purposes, of barking up the wrong tree. Regardless of the indisputable value which may be accredited to the solid biography on Kaj Munk by the Danish Minister of Foreign Affairs, Per Stig Møller, it does not hit the bull's eye. It takes too much notice of the less important aspects of Kaj Munk's insincere, somehow superficial, marginal notes of, for instance, the structure of a coming post-war society. An important issue in Kaj Munk's clash with the pagan, materialistic Danish society in the view on sacrifice and suffering were ways most part conspicuous between Christianity and the social welfare state. That's an option where ways are to part. Quite sophisticatedly, Kaj Munk visualizes the presence of the radical liberal party in the Garden of Gethsemane, shunning sacrificial suffering like poison, shaking their heads in credulity to a situation which threatens to get out of control, energetically persisting on a negotiated settlement. If the radical liberal party had had its way, Kaj Munk dispassionately remarked, what would then have become of salvation? Of great importance is it to make inquiry into the theological nature and character of the preconditions for Kaj Munk's position in general, the Christology and pneumatology of Kaj Munk, his perception of the kingdom of God. This is, however, a delicate piece of work, an act of balance, where to tread carefully and watch one's step. In many instances, you get the impression that, for example, on the issue of violence, had a leaning towards the attitude that violence was an alien element in Christianity and a consequence of the fall of man, but under certain circumstances, a divinely approved emergency solution when committed by a person pure, simple of heart, and devoid of ulterior motives. What most of all stirred him and aroused his suspicion to a dogmatic pacifism were the real and not alleged motives of pacifist opposition to armed resistance. Upon the whole, he doubted strongly that pacifists had noble and genuine motives for their stand. Intentionally, I, in the first place, withheld the conclusion in order not to devitalize the audience. Now I should like to read it now, anyhow, part of it, the conclusion. I suppose that some of them have, of you have read most of this, or some of this paper. What I have been saying until now may be regarded as reflections, deliberations, suggestions, and indications now calling for some sort of a conclusion. If I were to classify this paper, I should denominate it a theological treatise, more than a political response. Jesus Christ is the alleged principal character. He is a yardstick of Kaj Munk's evaluation of the ethical standard of his society in the first half of the previous century. How important the issue of Christology is, how urgent a thorough elucidation of and investigation into Kaj Munk's perception of the essence and core of Christianity is for the justification and acceptance of his alleged martyrdom goes almost without saying. In the vital and overriding search for truth, which is an obligation to all sincere believers, we are obliged to reach out for such a clarification. And in all matters of faith, we might be victims of a delusion. Kaj Munk himself might have been a victim of a delusion, believing that he pursued goals that he in fact did not pursue. He might furthermore have been wrong in his interpretation of his sacrifice as a martyrdom. His apparently clear-cut distinction of what damaged his nation's relationship to Germany and to the Lord Jesus Christ may rest on a misjudgment. The reason for an acknowledgement of a martyrdom is not that a person considers himself a martyr, nor that his surroundings to a certain extent support this assumption. Not even that the church conveys this distinction upon him. Many martyrs have been strictly in opposition to their church background. Besides the issue of Christology and even pneumatology, Kaj Munk prophetically considered himself momentarily and sporadically under the influence of the Holy Spirit. Kaj Munk's notion of the nature of the kingdom of God, the will of God, and the nature of worldly regime is of equal and related importance. The kingdom of God, which according to the Lord's Prayer, should be fulfilled in us, as it is in heaven. As Christian Eisenberg, the politische Predigt, Kaj Munk, refreshingly underlines, and now I speak German, then you can judge how fluent my German is. Kaj Munk wendet sich vor allem gegen die Tendenz, die Forderung der Bergpredigt als utopisch anzusehen. Nach Munk will Jesus nicht Objekt des Glaubens und Gegenstand individueller Frömmigkeit sein, sondern will den Willen seines Vaters verkünden und seine Nachfolge berufen. Auch wenn die Gemeinde durch die Bergpredigt immer wieder bloßgestellt wird, für Munk gelten die Worte in einem unmittelbaren Sinn. Jesus Worte wollen nicht weniger als Gottes Rechtordnung verkünden und zum Kampf für das Reich der Liebe auf dieser Welt des Hasses rufen. The assignment is that this Rechtordnung Gottes in heaven, unlimited and unrestricted, should be enforced also on earth. And to the best of Kaj Munk's ability, he did not detect this enforcement in the policies and practices of the first half of the 20th century of his country and neighboring countries. Where were any signs that Europe, by chance, as a young theological student had proposed, had made Jesus king? And how were the prospects for a false alarm for his foreboding? At the same time, everybody who has lost the Spirit of God has to die, because in the Spirit of God there is life. The validity of Kaj Munk's struggle and martyrdom, when all is dead and done, is a matter between him and his Savior, a confrontation he both feared and confided in. And maintained, as maintained by a Dutch pastor, a central idea in Kaj Munk's dramatic production is the clash between this Rechtordnung Gottes and the Eigengesetzlichkeit des Staates. In my opinion, an essential remark, she says, the Dutch pastor, to Hegel's fatal idolization of the state as the concretization of bonum optimum. The general attitude is that Kaj Munk is a poor theologian. A great many, especially Dutchmen, do not share this view. But also a German repudiates this superficial judgment. One of the most peculiar experiences I ever had was when Christian Eisenberg gave a lecture on Kaj Munk and Bonhoeffer at the Theological Faculty of Copenhagen in front of a considerable audience. To the surprise and credulity of the audience, he assured that Kaj Munk easily met the requirements. A Swede, Lennart Nielsen, taking the coherence between Kaj Munk's criticism of society and the Rechtordnung Gottes, the kingdom of God on earth as it is in heaven, into account, inferred after a longer instruction. To demand from Kaj Munk that he should canonize the following events and factors as an expression of God's Rechtordnung would be quite sensational, quite a sensation. That Stalin, to his death 1942, Danish Prime Minister, was unshakably convinced that Germany would win the war and that Denmark should adapt to this incontestable fact. That Germany had no problems in recruiting Danish soldiers to the Waffen-SS, and that more than 5,000 of these young lads lost their lives in Russia, and the rest, on their return after the war, were sued and punished by the same people who had encouraged them to go over there. That one of their prominent leaders, Captain Christian Frederick Schalburg, by the government was honored with a state funeral. That the Germans had no problems in procuring labor for the fortification of the Jutlandish West Coast, a measure which resulted in the deaths of more than 1,400 British airmen, and that Danish agriculture abundantly supplies to Germany prolonged the war with several months, causing unnecessary hardship and suffering for millions. I would say, the Swedish guy stated, I would say that if Hitler's Germany was an offense to the good Lord, why should his faithful assistant Denmark have another status? Apparently, the Allies shared the same opinion. The Russians had not quite recovered from the Danish SS fighters and the internment of the Communist Party in 1942. And the signing of the anti-communist treaty by the Danish Prime Minister in Berlin 1941. Our Western allies did not find it worthwhile inviting Denmark to the festivities in connection with the D-Day in Normandy. Denmark was simply not considered an ally. The international criticism of our attitude to the third world, I don't believe that. in as much as martyrdom can be considered a sacrament, a gift of the Holy Spirit to the Church, a tool to the spreading and growth of the kingdom of God, it is necessarily in its exclusiveness and radicalism a stumbling block, a process of selection, elimination, expulsion, and admonition that Christianity on your own term is problematic, if not an unacceptable affair, anyhow within certain areas. Was Jaeger's message, if you go straight to the point, not a demonstration of that aggression, conquest, and military expansion are incompatible with the kingdom of God? And by taking part in such activities, you have in reality excluded yourself from Christian community. And not just a formal question of the right of an individual to become a conscientious objector, refusing to join the armed forces on moral grounds. Doesn't it go wider? And wouldn't Romeo's fight against the exploitation of the campesinos imply the same self-elected, although not realized, exclusion of the kingdom of God, no matter which conclusion Romeo for his own part arrived at? This is very important, his own notion of his opponents. Kaj Munk's call to his fellow Christians in the Cathedral of Copenhagen to an insurrection against the anti-Semitic curse and plague wasn't that in fact an announcement that such a conduct by the perpetrators in reality excluded them from the kingdom of God, no matter how much they themselves were inclined to consider their behavior as a crime? Especially when you take the radicalism of Kaj Munk's view on martyrdom into account. Although Karl Rahner emphasizes the immense value of martyrdom and its sacramentally exceptional position, it is of importance to him to articulate that martyrdom does not pertain to fundamental theology, but must be content with a corner in the Christian creed. Kaj Munk's martyrdom becomes seemingly more and more a cornerstone within the Christian creed. On occasion, he might refer to martyrdom as an aristocratic element, a matter to which ordinary Christian people weren't committed. But in the Cathedral in Copenhagen, he almost inculcates martyrdom as a Christian duty, as a token of true loyalty to Christ. The incontestable decline and insignificance of the Church compared to the influence and power of the ideologies of his age, the new religions, stem from the fact that the Church had lost its second most precious jewel, the mental disposition of martyrdom. The most precious jewel is Christ himself. Christ and the sacrificial affection and loyalty to him is the complementary axis of Christianity. Kaj Munk could not escape the impression that to Paul and the first Christian, Christ was the full, alive, and kicking reality. A storm of disasters had been the price of their loyalty to him, although Christ must have foreseen that he had the courage to inflict these sufferings upon them. Nowadays, you may come across people who profess, "I am not afraid of running risk, I for my part, but doing it may have consequences for others, and I don't do it for the sake of these others." Christ was a warrior. He was in the front row, but he did not shrink back from dragging his men into a situation where death, agony, and mutilation was the hero's reward. And they followed him without hesitation, proud, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer shame for his name as it says in Acts chapter 5. And then Kaj Munk, in fact, addresses one and each in the cathedral with a general claim. Oh, my Christian friends, that is our destiny. Not for our own benefit, not to get hold of a seat in the stalls of heaven, but because we belong to Christ, no matter how half-hearted and sleepy we are. We are Christians. That means that the kingdom is entrusted to us. Well, then we have some overriding deliberation. Fiat justitia imperius mundus. That was for the old Roman they claimed. If the discussion about unarmed resistance against uncompromising evil not is going to degenerate into superficial position, we must admit that there are no limits whatsoever to the escalation of atrocities. I once touched this problem with the legendary Johannes Müllerhave, one of our cultural mandarins. In his opinion, not even the extermination of 6 million Jews did justify a military encounter with Hitler's Germany. Immediately after the occupation of Denmark, a lot of so-called experts expected, at best, 30 years under German dominion. The conduct of the Third Reich in Eastern Europe leaves no illusion about the political ambition and the final result. Under the biological shadow of a politicized and philosophically integrated Charles Darwin, the asserted biological superiority of the Aryan race implied a gradual cleansing of all inferior races, encompassing not only the Slavic people, but also the Latin. An unimaginable Holocaust was on the drawing board. A nuclear Germany would only have compounded the prospect of a universal Holocaust. The senseless arms race and the overriding persistence on fiat justitia imperat mundus, let justice be done even if the world goes down, will very likely end up in an Armageddon. But it should never be concealed that a negation of the principle fiat justitia imperat mundus is equal to a bargain with the devil. The most extraordinary things about the situation, an English scientist stated, is that the world acts, plans, and reasons as it wasn't in the midst of an apocalyptic era. As a matter of fact, a serious discussion on armed and unarmed resistance must take into consideration devastation on an unlimited scale. The outcome of the discussion might very well up in a real ethical dilemma and not in an organized and strategic like the chief part of today's ethical dilemmas. Where ethical dilemma is definitely out of question in a legitimate appropriation of the fruits of victory of a just cause is imaginable. According to Kaj Munk, it was ethical utmost rejectable to side with German for 2 or 3 years, calculating the German victory, and then towards the end to shift to the enemies of Germany and saluting the Allied liberators enthusiastically. If there had been decent and respected people, they ought to have mourned the defeat of Germany on the 5th of May 1945. Opportunism, in Kaj Munk's view, was incompatible with Christianity.